platform. Please welcome Kath Payne.
Thanks very much, Anders. So as Anders said, I am very, very passionate to the point where actually one of my passions is that when we do a search on Google Trends, email marketing is actually going to be above sex, right? So, and I can imagine, I feel like speaking for all of the speakers here, that we all, you know, feel pretty much the same. Now, the title today is 7 Best Practices for B2B Email Marketing. Now, I know not all of you are B2B email marketers, but I would love to know who actually are. Okay. So what I'm going to try and do is a lot of what I'm saying here is also, whilst it's specifically targeted for B2B, there's a lot of takeaways also for B2C, right? The variances are, you know, generally the size of the database and so on. But anyhow, let's progress. So this is me. I currently am a consultant and a trainer and a speaker, and this is pretty much what I do, and I've got some wonderful clients. And this is often the picture that I walk into when I'm talking with a B2B class. They're tearing their hair out because what they are struggling with are some of the challenges that B2C marketers don't have. So B2C marketers generally are swimming in data. You have large lists. B2B marketers generally have small lists. So a lot of the best practices, we say segment. When you're talking about B2B, it's very hard to actually be segmenting, because then you're talking sometimes, just is it worth sending a campaign just to a couple of hundred? So what I'm going to be talking about today is a few little workarounds and how you can still achieve best practice but also make it work for you. Now, I want to also just point out that best practice is best practice. Okay, so it's something to aim for, but it's not necessarily realistic in most companies' schedules. It doesn't necessarily align all the time with your business goals as well. So these are the sort of things that you have to work out. Just don't implement immediately and just say flat out, we have to achieve best practice. It's something to aim for, but it's not always going to be giving you the results that you require for your business goals. So just keeping in mind, but like I said. Okay, so secrets to the B2B success. Now, what we're going to be looking at today are these 7 little secrets. They're not really secret at all, but let's pretend they are. So gain permission. I'll be talking about that extensively, because B2B email marketing here is currently not, it's an opt-out one, so you don't need to gain permission. So, but I have got gain permission there, so it's pretty interesting. Segment. As I said before, there's a few challenges around B2B with segmenting. Automate. Mark did talk about some automation, and I'm going to talk about different types of automation. of course, have relevant consumable content. Now, today's B2B marketing is very much about content marketing. So we will be talking a little bit about how you can be utilizing that to be growing your list, to be engaging your audiences, and then, of course, to be achieving the conversions that you require. Designing for conversions. So here we're talking about some tactical little tips for you. And running for conversion, and then, of course, there we go, optimizing for conversion. Because this is what we're talking about, is conversion. We're not just sending out emails for the sake of sending out emails. They all have an objective, or they should have an objective. And they need to be, we need to be focusing on what that objective is in order for us to be achieving our conversions. If we don't actually know what that objective is, it's very hard to achieve it. So, first point is, which I haven't got down there, is understand your objective, not just for your whole strategy, but for each and every email that goes out. So let's look at the first one. So I've got a bit of a frog in the throat. Gaining permission. So we heard from Anders before that the ROI of email marketing is wonderful. One of the reasons why the ROI is so good is because primarily it is seen as a permission channel. And we ask for permission to send them the relevant content. Hence, we have got warm leads already. Now, as I said before, it's opt-out here for B2B, and you can leverage that. Of course, I'm not saying don't, but understand that it's a different ball game there. It's a different market. Different tactics, different content need to be used accordingly with these not warm leads, right? So the fact that it is a permission-based channel is absolutely brilliant, and it's one of the strengths of email marketing. So if we just look at a nice little example here, this one is basically what we're wanting to do is look is utilizing all the touch points. So someone has come to your website via whatever channel, so whether it's Google AdWords, Facebook ads, a recommendation, a social post, whatever the story is, they've been driven to your website. So ensure that you are making the most of that opportunity. I am astonished at how often I will go and check out a website and find out that those touch points aren't there. Or, even worse, as Mark was saying beforehand too, you'll see what happens is that the social icons are placed in the top right hand above the fold, right? And then you have to scroll to the very, 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 very bottom. And then in a little tiny bottom right-hand corner, subscribe to our newsletter. What I ask you here in this case is, what is that company's objective? Is it to grow their Facebook fans, their Twitter fans? Is that where the money is? Or are the conversions actually happening in their email database? And therefore, the priority of placement should actually be with the newsletter. So it should be placed above the fold, right, where we can actually access it. Now our subscribers can keep in contact with us, and we get to use that information. So if we have a look at this one here, it's just simply if you are using social media or anything to be distributing content, whatever kind of content, it could even be an infographic, try and capture their data. This is a wonderful opportunity. They're actually wanting something from you. Understand that each the consumer and at the end of the day, even business people as consumers, right? So I'll talk about consumers. At the end of the day, they're very, very savvy, and they understand that their data is worth something to you. So what we have to do is we have to create the value exchange. Now, that value exchange means, yes, we are giving them something, whether it is a quarterly newsletter, a monthly newsletter, an infographic, a white paper, a video to watch, whatever the story is, they understand that there is that value exchange. So at this point, because we are giving them something, we can leverage that. So make sure you are leveraging all of those opportunities. Now, this is a nice one too, so you might also be interested in. So this is an upsell, a cross-sell. This is making the most of that opportunity again. So they've downloaded a white paper. You know that they're interested. So you then go and tag on some other interesting or potentially interesting, you know, offers that you have got and get them. So with the B2B, we are very much looking at nurturing. So we're talking lead nurturing. We're talking about using what's called the nudge factor. The nudge factor is simply a matter of, you know, ensuring that you have got, you're creating that relationship and you've got a nice little sort of stream of communication within their inbox, which then what that enables you to do that when they are looking, because it's a good chance that they're actually getting the same sort of thing from your competitors. However, of course, if you're doing a better job than them, you're going to be standing out in the inbox rather than the competitor, and that's what you're aiming at. So again, this is nice. Customer service and being helpful goes a long, long way. And then, of course, gather more information. Now, if we go back to the very, very first point, which is gaining permission, sometimes all we want to do is capture their email address, maybe their first name, their surname, right? we don't have to ask absolutely everything about them at the first point. We can always build upon that later on. So therefore, we can gather more information. This particular one is actually, I've downloaded a white paper. They've gone and did that cross-sell. I've gone and downloaded, I wanted to download another white paper. And they've gone and said to me, okay, we already know who you are. Let's ask you a little bit more information. So what they're doing is they're just slowly building up their information. That's called progressive profiling. So, and that's a really, really neat thing to do because you're not placing any barriers to conversion at the first point. You're asking them for minimal information. And that means that you get permission to contact them. So we're up to number two, segment. As I said, segmentation is very tricky when it comes to B2B. So if we start thinking about this strategically, and how can we actually make it easy for ourselves? One of the ideal ways of segmenting is actually, certainly for B2B, is basing it on where they're at in the buying cycle. And one of the nice little tactics that you can use is particularly if they're using a search, you know, they're using search terms, so either a Google AdWords or even search optimization, so they're actually searching for these words, you can direct them to a particular page which has the download, the white paper, whatever the content is that you are directing them to. Capture their information and understand that they've used a very, very generic phrase. So most likely, they're actually only at the very beginning of that buying cycle. They haven't even started. Maybe they've not even heard about you. So a lot of education needs to be done. However, conversely, they might actually put in your brand. Or they might actually put in, you know, a specific terminology that you know from your past experience means that they're more along the line of the buying cycle. So you can start segmenting immediately based on capturing that information. What that particular page that you've driven to them to, based on those search terms, will then put them into a certain segment. And you know where they are in the buying cycle and you can start nurturing them based on that. It'll get there one day. There we go. Another way, of course, is sort of growing from that one, is segmenting based on the customer life cycle. So you don't want to be talking to your prospects and your customers and your subscribers and your loyal customers and your lapsed customers the same tone, the same content, the same offers. They all need to be segmented. So even though we are talking small databases, this basic segmentation ideally needs to be done. We need to be recognizing, are they a really loyal customer? If they are, then maybe we want to be sending them more offers more frequently. That's something to be testing. If they're just a prospect, remember we have to be using the lead nurturing and warming them up and educating them about us, our services, our products, and so on. We, of course, don't need to be doing that with our customers or our loyal customers. Our customers, we're probably wanting to be focusing on upselling and cross-selling. So each of these different segments have got their own objectives that we need to be catering our particular communications accordingly. I'm having fun today. Hello, there we go. Okay, we can also, of course, be segmenting based on that collected data. So you might have a preference center. I remember in one of the first screens I was showing you, that progressive profiling. So what that means then is that we can use that data and we can be segmenting accordingly. Again, of course, a lot of this it depends on how logistically feasible it is. So, you know, is it going to be worth your while as such? Are you going to be achieving the ROI accordingly for all that effort put in? So, and that's if we're talking about manually segmenting. The next one I'm going to be talking about is automating, which is all done for you. And it makes a lot more sense. And then, of course, we can be segmenting based on their actual actions, as Mark was saying. And this here is actually a video that Mark did, and I encourage you to go to his email marketing reports, or it's been split off, site, and search it out. It's very, very funny. Anyhow, so, thank you. Okay, so this is another thing that we can be doing. And once we start doing something like this, we can either manually then go and say, okay, everyone who has clicked on this particular link or watched this video or so on and so on, we can manually segment them and send them more data. Or we can start automating. Right. And this is the key. Like I said before, B2B, very much talking about lead nurturing, about sending that relevant content. And different to what Mark was saying, when Mark was saying, you know, using the triggers for shopping cart abandonment for the B2C type thing, which of course you actually can do with B2B as well, white paper downloads. They didn't quite finish in that form. You can actually use the same tactic to email them back and be of customer service. But what I'm really talking about here is, again, that nudge factor. So just having that presence in their inbox, being of customer service to them, taking advantage of that particular touch point, knowing that they are interested and that they have contacted you somehow, and either by, yes, a click, watching the video, downloading the white paper. So here's some nice little statistics about automating. Thank you. Okay, so Forrester Research found that companies that excel at lead nurturing generate 50% more sales-ready leads at 33% the lower cost. And this is what I was talking about. So don't despair if you've got a smaller database. Understand that if you can segment, and then in addition to the segmenting, the actual automating, it actually can work out. Of course, you have to work that out for your own business, but you know, it's certainly something to look into and something to test and see if it does work for you. And Uetis group found out that nurtured leads make 47% larger purchases than non-nurtured leads. Okay, so nurturing is very much about the automation. We don't want to have someone sitting there and replying to every download or anything like that and manually sending them out. This really needs to be triggered. It needs to be automated. And this is where this is why the ROI is so high, because it's happening behind the scenes. We set it up once, and then it's just making it all happen behind the scenes and generating that ROI for us. Okay, here's a really, really obvious and simple example. So this is marketing profs, and what they do is they have a welcome program. And this, of course, and Mark did touch on this too, and this, of course, is ideal for B2C as well. So B2C, we have got, we've got welcome emails. Again, I'm surprised at how many B2C companies don't do them. I'm also very, very surprised at how many B2B companies don't do a single welcome email. If you're thinking about this particular opportunity, it's at the point where someone has gone to your website, however they were driven there, and they have liked what they've seen, enough so that they have filled in a form and they say, we want to hear more from you. Now, to actually not take advantage of that and not to send something immediately, to have that presence in the inbox, is a very, very missed opportunity. If you want to build upon that wonderful opportunity, you can start doing a program. And I've seen some really, really nice examples of programs. It's really just a matter of setting their expectations and saying, we will be sending you 3-4 emails within the next week, 2 weeks. You know, just to let you know, to make sure that you are you know, making the most of our service. And it needs to be written in a very customer service-oriented way again. The customer needs to understand and see immediately what's in it for me. And then once that happens, it's generally, it works really, really well. And these often are the most highly engaged emails that you're ever going to send. So here we go. Marketing profs do a 4-part series, and I've only got the 3 here at the moment, I think, yes. So, yeah, so I've got 1, 2, and 4. So, anyhow, what they're doing here is it's a tutorial. Again, it's that education. They're building that relationship so that when you are wanting to have some email information, then marketing profs is who you go to, right? We can use the same concept. That's what we're wanting to do. We want to be there when they are ready to buy. And this is where all this nurturing comes into. Okay. We can also be using the whole automation to be upselling and cross-selling as well. Again, making it easy. Here's just another example. And I really like this one too, because what happens often, if you're talking about, say, a white paper download, and who here actually does white paper, promotes white papers as content? White papers? Anyone? Any other content? Does anyone do content marketing? Yep. Okay, great. So this is great for content marketing. Instead of actually driving them, once they've filled in that form, and then they go to the actual landing page, instead of giving them that item right away so they can download it on the landing page, ensure that when they're subscribing, you say, we will be sending this to your inbox. Because more often than not, we are, by nature, humans are a little bit on the lazy side, and if we can get away with things, we will. You know, so often we will sort of, you know, not if we know that we're going to go to that landing page and get to download that data, download that report, we're not necessarily going to be putting in quality information into that subscription form. However, if we know that the only way we're going to get that report is by it being sent to our email address, then what you're doing is you're ensuring that quality data. You're ensuring that you have got a valid email address. So that's a good thing to do, and this is what these guys do. So that's nice. Okay, I think I'm going to swap over sides and see if it's any easier. Okay, so here we go again. So have relevant consumable content. Content, let's have a look at the top three ones here. You can see content marketing is actually growing. And for B2B, it's an ideal situation. So blogs, videos, white papers, they are the three, but they're not the only type of content, obviously. Basically, everything is content. It's how we sell it. It's how we package it up. Content can also be used, can be repackaged for different mediums as well, or different channels. So we could be using something that we have actually used on our social media site, our Facebook site, but then we repackage it again. Maybe we'll turn that into a PowerPoint, or something that was a PowerPoint, we'll turn it into a presentation, or something that was a PowerPoint, we'll turn that into a PDF. All of these sort of things, you know, just understand that we can work out what works best for our audience and what works best for us as well. Don't think that we have to be spending a lot of budget all the time creating content. Content is simply, as Mark said, if we look at our social media, the usage, what is consumed, that gives us a really nice idea of what potentially our clients are going to be wanting to be consuming via email as well. So if we have a look, this particular slide, you can see that content growth and the consumption of content is growing, right? So I think the big takeaway here, and I was surprised that so few of you do it, is if you're not doing it, there's a good chance that your competitor is. And if they're doing it and you're not doing it, then that's a huge missed opportunity, because it gives you that reason for getting into their inbox. It's a wonderful opportunity to building that relationship. Okay, still no luck. Here's some other examples of content. So you've got white papers, as I said, webinars, that's also content. Infographics, as I mentioned before, content. And then you've got ebooks. I mean, this is just the list is endless. Very much videos also. I could do a whole session on video and email. Videos are one of these little gems which are absolutely, you know, YouTube. Is YouTube very popular here? Yep. It's the growth of YouTube is phenomenal. And we are now becoming addicted to videos. And an email is a fantastic delivery tool to provide those videos. So definitely, if you can do videos, and videos are fantastic for B2B. We love hearing professionals, we love hearing experts talk about things. Not necessarily about your products. You don't want to be selling all the time. You just want to be adding, you know, a customer service, additional services. There we go. Okay, so now we're looking at some more tactical things, designing for conversion. This is an interesting one. So designing for images blocked. That's not an email, by the way. I haven't clicked on it yet. That's one. Okay. So here we go. We've got e-consultancy over in the UK. And this is a lovely B2B designed email. You can see here, it has got images. There's a logo there. Now let's have a look at it with the images off. It's still actionable. If we have a look very closely, see that there? That's using known as a bulletproof button. And let's go back and have a look at that again. Okay, see? Looks very similar. It's just missing that image at the very end. So what we're wanting to do is make sure that our emails are actionable even with the images off. So, and I'm going to go talk to the next one. Oh, and also, let's have a look here. They've done a really, really nice job too with having a look at, see how they've got the alt text as well. You don't have to just be functional and practical with your alt text. You can be promotional with it. You can be persuasive with it. So try and experiment and see what actual alt text works well with yours too. Because understand that Outlook is one of the biggest email clients in the B2B industry. In fact, Outlook is still one of the biggest ones in B2C as well. And Outlook blocks images by default. Now, Outlook actually doesn't show alt tags, but nevertheless, it still is something that we need to be understanding that even with the uptake of iPhones, iPads, which download images automatically, we still have to primarily be designing for images blocked. It's ideal. So, there we go. Now, this is an interesting one. So this is what I call designing for the golden real estate. And the golden real estate is, am I late? Okay. The golden real estate essentially is this valuable area here. And that's if you've got a preview pane, a vertical preview pane, and a horizontal preview pane, you overlap them together. This is what is the common denominator. And this is what we need to be designing for. And also, if you have a look at that, that's also BlackBerry and Android. So that is the first screen. So this here is the primary real estate that we need to be looking at. It needs to have the big heading, the call to action. The what's in it for me needs to be communicated here. And of course, that call to action needs to be actionable even with images blocked. Okay, let's go. Thank you. Writing for conversion. Okay, on average, 8 out of 10 people will read headline copy, but only 2 out of 10 will read the rest. So we really, really need to be focusing very much on the headlines. This is also for the consumer as well, so B2C. Headlines, subject lines, these are the big factors. So, you know, as I think it is Ogilvy says, spend 80% of your time focusing on your headline and only 20% of your time on the actual copy. Because that's what's going to be grabbing them. And also, the call to action needs to be really, really thought out. Here, very, very nice, quick example. We've got Email Evolution Conference, last chance to register by Saturday. And we've got some little bullet points. Versus this. Make it scannable. Make it understand that you are wanting to achieve an objective. And you know what? So do they. So make it as easy for them to achieve that objective, which helps you to achieve your objective, right? So make it easy. Just little things like that can make a huge uplift. Now, optimizing for conversion. Here's some little tests here from whichtest1.com. Really, really nice examples from you know, people, brands such as yourselves who go and submit them. And this is just really, really wanting to impart upon you how important it is to test. I know that with B2B, testing is always a bit of an issue because, again, we've got the number factor, right? We're saying it's really difficult to be testing because we don't have that huge volume to be testing on, but it can be done. And it's definitely well worth doing it. Even if, depending on the size, you might even want to be putting each email as a test and trying to learn something from it. So in this particular example, really, really simple, form on the left or form on the right. Form on the right, 24% more submissions. Who wants that? Yeah? Was it worth it? Yep. Was it difficult to do? No? Didn't take any extra budget, you know, maybe half an hour maximum. So definitely worth doing. This one here, descriptive versus benefits. This is for a subject line. Increased customer retention by 8% in a single month versus SaaS billing is a market asset. Again, what's in it for me will always win. So understand it needs to be written from the customer's perspective, not from the brand's perspective. Don't sell at them. Let them know that the benefit. There we go. Oops, sorry. The version A increased leads by 62%. Huge. And then final one, make the call to action appropriate to where they're at in the buying cycle. If we have a look here, flip through the brochure versus click and save online. Now, click and save online is nice, but for this, remember what I was saying at the very beginning, understand where they're at in the buying cycle because it will make a huge difference. And this is a very granular example of what the difference will be according to where they are. 301% uplift because they hit the nail on the head with the appropriate call to action for where they were at. So that's all from me today, and I think I did go over. I'm really sorry. And I'll hand back to Anders.
So thank you very much for bringing some practical advice to us. I think there are a lot of thoughts that everybody here in the room can bring with them to the office, and next time they go back to working with email, there are some stuff that we can do to make it even better for next time. We have some questions for you from the audience, and please continue questions to either email eme@apsys.com or by using the app. The first question we have for you today is this one.
Okay, yeah, so is designing for mobile devices necessary for B2B? I specifically didn't address this because I knew that we had a few other speakers talking on it, so I won't talk too long on this, but absolutely, it is. Again, if what we're wanting them to do is to be actioning our emails, to be standing out in their inbox, to be getting their attention, to have that nudge effect, they have to be able to read our emails to begin with. So definitely, either option of what Mark was saying, the mobile-friendly one, single column, making sure you've got the big clickable buttons, the what's in it for me is very obvious. Again, designing for that preview pane area, or the responsive design using media queries, absolutely brilliant. But I would definitely say yes.
Okay, thank you. One more question for you.
Okay, newsletters. Yes, I specifically didn't mention newsletters because everyone seems to talk about them, but does everyone have a newsletter? B2B, B2C, pretty normal? Yes, they drive revenue, absolutely. But the problem with newsletters is that they're often underappreciated by the actual company who are sending them. They don't do the tracking, they don't do the appropriate tracking, so they're not actually tracking the revenue that's coming from them. And so what happens is that the budget isn't being put into them. The strategy, most newsletters go out without a strategy, without an actual objective. The only objective is we need to send out a newsletter because we have to have something out there, right? And that's not a good objective at all. And also from experience, I know that most and I'm not saying all of you guys do it, but there's a lot of brands out there, both B2B and B2C, who will be running around the Wednesday evening before the newsletter's due out on the Thursday, going, what shall we put in it? Has anyone got any content? What can we... You're right? They're very ad hoc, very thrown together, and you know what? They're not going to achieve anything because of that. So understand, it needs to have their objective, needs to be strategically planned, have that content plan, have a contact plan. All of these things need to be taken into consideration, and then you'll achieve wonderful ROI. But, you know, at the end of the day, you need to be offering something that your audience wants, and that needs a bit of thought behind it.
Yes, so. I think we can both agree that email is often a very underestimated channel of generating revenue. Okay, thank you very much for being here with us today.
Thank you.
So our next speaker is someone I first met at an email marketing conference in Florida. And we were actually so impressed by her knowledge, so we decided to hire her to work with APSIS team. So please welcome on stage for our first case study of the day, Kelly Lorenz.
Hello, good morning. I'm going to be presenting this case study on behalf of APSIS, as well as our partner in crime on this, which is Gran Gordon, and our marketing coordinator there, which is Sophia Stolros. Sophia? My name is Kelly Lorenz, like Anders said. As you may be able to tell, as I try to pronounce the lovely Swedish names in this case, that I'm not originally from here. I'm actually from the US, where I worked for many years on my own email program, as well as on clients' email programs, before meeting Anders in Florida and getting recruited to APSIS to start up our strategic service offering. So that's a little bit about me. Let's talk about the case. So Gran Gordon, in short, essentially is a company that was established in 1880. And if you live here in Sweden, you know the name Gran Gordon. It is very well known. It's well established. However, originally they were known as really serving farmers. They were known as Lantmännen. And now they're focused more on changing their strategy to focus on private individuals and really entrepreneurs to do anything outdoors. So not just farming, but gardening, any kind of outdoor activities with animals, things like that. They have stores all throughout the country in 110 cities, so you really can't go anywhere without stumbling over one of their stores. They are only retail stores at the moment, so we're not online yet. They have over 800 employees and 2 billion in turnover each year, so they are a very well-known brand. They also have what's called their Gran Gordon Club, which is essentially 640,000 members, which is quite large considering the size of Sweden. And of that, when you become a member of their club, you can also subscribe to their email program. So they kind of go hand in hand. So of the 640,000 members that they have, 170,000 of them are also email subscribers. So it's about 27%. So keep that number in mind. We'll come back to it. Who are they targeting? Well, really, they are targeting any Swede that enjoys rural life, animals, and outdoor activities like gardening. So that's really a niche for them, but it's really three niches, right? So we have the farmers, we have the people who are interested in raising farm-like animals, horses, pigs, chickens, things like that. And then we also have gardeners. So if you think about it, there's really three different target audiences here tied into this overall outdoor living type audience. Their business goal, first and foremost, they want to be positioned as the experts in agriculture and gardening, as well as being known for selling products that meet every need. They have thousands of products, you guys. I don't know if you know that, but it's exciting because they compete with companies like ICA and Coop and the mom and pop stores on the corner, but what they really sell is their expertise. And so what they're trying to do really is make outdoor living and gardening almost as sexy as email, right? And so what they're doing with their email program, as you remember, everybody that gets their emails are also members of their club, so they have been to the stores previously, is what we're trying to do is build member relationships and drive them to the stores to buy stuff. So when we started working together, we had a few key issues to address. First and foremost, there was real no clear strategy or focus for the team. You know, Sophia, bless her heart, was essentially by herself working to try to pull something together to send an email at all. So what she was running into is issues with resources and time and focus. There really wasn't anything going on internally to say, how are we going to use email effectively? This clicker is terrible. Okay, difficulty measuring success. With any offline retailer and with B2B, as you find out, it's very difficult to tie sales directly to your email program. So we really don't know when we deploy an email what is the actual impact of that? Because there is no direct string that ties those two things together. And that's a real big issue for companies, and everybody in here, I'm sure, has the same issue, to get more resources and time to do email well, like you've heard from Mark and from Kath already, to do it well, because you just don't have any proof. Irregular sending. So without a strategy, without a clear focus, without the resources, it was essentially, oh, we're sending out a print flyer, we should also do an email. And it was never really any clear calendar. It was whenever they could get to it, so maybe once a month or less. Everyone was getting the same content. As we looked at with the target audience, there's really three audiences here. So everybody getting the same thing is not really as effective, because if we're selling tractors, for instance, it's not really going to appeal to people who only have animals or who only prefer gardening and maybe have a small garden in the city. Not optimizing for email. So this is what we had when we started. And while I really like the skids, I think they're called, and I understand some people up north ride them to school, which is, we don't do that in the States, just so you know, but it's interesting, but the fact is that this was what their print flyer looked like, and so what they did is they said, okay, we're promoting skids, so let's put them in the email as well, maybe a little bit about the environment, no real call to action, it's just informative. We have different types of skids. If you're a pro, if you're a kid, if you're just beginning to learn, we have the skid for you. Okay. So we had three challenges that we were looking to address. First and foremost, we want to create those appealing newsletters that meet our customers' needs. We want to communicate invites. There's a lot of things happening at the stores, right? And with the gardening seminars and with farming tools and things like that. Exclusive offers. Hopefully, if they're member holders or loyalty members, they get something else out of it besides a card. Yay! You know, something else. News to them as well, so we want to make sure that they're informed on what the latest products are, what's going on with the company, anything like that. And then finally, just raise awareness on what Grand Gordon actually has to offer. It is thousands of products and the expertise to back it up, and obviously we want to generate a higher return on investment. So the solution that we proposed is a strategic workshop. So my team, we focused on helping them move forward by sitting down, 4-hour session, brainstorming everything of where are we today, what are we looking to do, and how do we do it, and came up with a plan. First, we had to change the template. Okay, we really wanted to optimize it, not only for email, but for what our goals are. We wanted to make sure our members understood what we had to offer and why they should shop with us. So this is an example of one of the newsletters that is after some of the changes that were made. They had themes to them. So this theme was gardening. How do I do gardening effectively? Some tips. And then, oh, by the way, we have the products to meet those needs. So it's a totally different strategy, much more expertise advice than product focus. So, yes, focus on selling the expertise in the outdoor activities so people don't just see them as they carry the products I need, because everybody else does as well. So we really wanted to separate and differentiate them from the ICAs and COOPs where they can get the products as well. Develop a marketing calendar with a set sending schedule by simply saying we're going to be sending an email out every single week. It gave them the push to say we're going to set up exactly what we want to communicate each and every week so that there are no surprises internally. Everybody's now on the same page with what our business goal is, what our target is, what we're trying to do with email marketing, and that we're sending on a regular basis. Also introduced segmented sends to different audiences. They were targeted and personalized, for instance, to people who had horses or dogs or chickens or whatever. And then also based off where they lived, so we could do some local store information. So they have a store here in Stockholm. So if you live here, you could get some deals and specials specifically for your local store. Integrate other marketing channels to support business goals. As you can probably tell, is that, you know, when you don't really have a set strategy for email and you sit down and focus, it kind of changes your direction for everything. And so what we wanted to do was bring everybody else up to speed with the offline efforts and with the website to make sure that they all match and tell the same story. So with all that said, what was the result? First and foremost, by just simply sitting down, developing a plan, they had a clear strategy internally where everybody is on the same page. So Sophia spent a lot of time and effort getting her team up to speed on here's exactly what we need to do moving forward. And that is a huge step for a lot of marketers to sit down and do that with their team. They're sending more frequently, which, as I found out through living here for more than a year now, is that people are scared of sending too much and scaring their audience and making them mad and unsubscribe and whatever. But they actually are getting much higher results just by sending more frequently on a set schedule with a theme. And they have clearer direction with their newsletter messaging as well. And the results speak for themselves. Everything is up across the board. Things that we can actually measure, obviously, is the open rate. It's not the sexiest metric, but it is something that we can clearly say, as a result of these changes, there was a 25% sustained 25% increase in the open rate. And most importantly, there's a boost in sales. So they sent out this email in early spring, talking about some products and garden soil and the bags that you can come and get in the store. And they promoted this one bag of soil just in the email, so nowhere else. And that produced 100% increase year over year in sales of those bags. So that's something clearly measurable that they can say, we didn't promote it anywhere else, just in email. And just using email alone to promote these increased sales 100% from last year. So now Sophia has the argument to take to her boss to say, we should make more of an effort here, have more people working on this, have more triggered messages and things like that. So the theme here, really, small changes, big impact. When I sit down with marketers every day is that I hear this thing of, we have so many ideas, we don't really know where to start. Well, every small step matters. It matters a lot. Sophia and her team didn't do too many things. They implemented a new template, they came up with a set sending schedule, and they have a strategy. Those three things produced enormous response. So when you get stuck in the idea of, oh, I need to have, you know, all the really cool things that you heard from Mark and Kath and that you'll hear from Andrew and Kevin and Tim as well, it's not necessarily right now that you have to do that, but just building slowly will help get you to that stage. And so it's kind of this idea of you go from this to this. Not overnight, but it's a huge change in your strategy. But unfortunately, that doesn't end there. The work never ends. Anybody who has met with me before knows that it's great, but is one of my favorite phrases. Because I do always have things to improve on. So we have a few things that we're going to work on moving forward. First and foremost, we want to add e-commerce. E-commerce is going to be huge for those people who aren't necessarily in our cities. We have 110 cities throughout the country. But for those people that can't necessarily easily access the store, we want to make sure they have the ability to buy. Triggered messages, specifically around birthday campaigns, when they buy something, life cycle messaging, things like that. Learning more about the members is very important. What do you want from us? Doing some regular surveying is really good because it helps give us some insight on what are the customers really looking for. Growing the subscriber database. So as you recall from the very beginning of the presentation, they only have about 27% of their members, their club members, on the list. That's a huge percentage, 73% that we could still get to subscribe. But not only that, we can go after non-members as well and sell them on the Gron Gordon story. Finally, we want to implement some SMS and mobile strategy. With offline retail, there's a huge opportunity to use mobile. Without an e-commerce site, you can have all kinds of things with apps and with text messaging and QR codes and things like that. So the story never ends, but they've made tremendous progress. Any questions? Yes, thanks.
And please keep the questions coming. I've got quite a few on email, through the app, and through Twitter. It's all excellent channels. I have two questions for you right now, and this is the first one.
Yeah, I think it's part of what I touched on with the idea of small changes, big impact, is that people feel stuck. You get in this idea of, okay, we have so many ideas, I don't really know what to start with. You get started on everything, and then nothing moves forward. You don't actually finish anything. And so part of what my job is really is to help clients say, what is most important to focus on? And that's really what you have to take away from this, is what is the most important thing to have first? What's going to give us the biggest impact? And then we move on to the next thing, and the next thing, and the next thing. It's small steps, not huge leaps.
Do you agree? I guess after listening to you and listening to Kath before, it's getting more and more obvious to me that companies are probably not measuring email marketing results good enough, and thereby not realizing how important it really is.
No, and that's the sad part about it, is I think Kevin is maybe a bigger geek about data than I am, but I do love data quite a lot. And it's something that's one of the first things I do when I talk to a client, is I'm like, oh, I'm seeing these trends in your numbers. And it's often, I don't even know that that's there. Some of the easiest things to measure with deliverability and open rates and click rates aren't necessarily the most important things. They are the easiest, but they're not what I care about, which is sales and results.
I think we can agree that email is often kind of the underestimated working horse of digital marketing. Let's take a look at the next question, if I can get it onto the screen here. Yeah. Here it is.
It's tough to say, because I think it works really effectively, SMS. I don't know how many people fly in Norwegian or SAS or those kinds of airlines, but they always do the SMS check-in. I have seen so many people use that when they're going to slide the barcode, is they pull it up on their phone, the SMS text message, they sign in, and then they scan it. So I think for certain marketers, it's still extremely effective. I'm not sure it's necessarily a sales tool so much as it is a relationship tool. So with SMS for Grongordon and offline retailers, for instance, it can be used to promote store hours. I think Mark mentioned that as one of them, with events and things like that. When we have this event, SMS message, we're starting in 5 minutes at, you know, Ringvagen, I think it is. Mm. Yeah. So I think it can be effective more for the relationship building.
Okay, excellent. And if you have any other questions that you didn't send in electronically, we can take them live here. If there's anything specific on this case? No. Then I actually had, and that's kind of funny, I don't get too many of these, but I got a question for myself. Thank you very much, very considerate. And that's if there will be presentations made available afterwards. And yes, we strive to make the presentations available. We expect to be able to send them out together with the evaluation that you'll all be receiving. Kelly, do you have any final words for this case?
No, I think we've driven home the small changes, big impact idea.
Yeah, and I really do take the time, understand what's happening, take the time to test. I've personally seen with just changing a subject line a little bit, results changing of about 20-25%. There's marvelous things that you can achieve with just a small change if you just find the time to do it right. Our next part on the agenda today is lunch, which will be served in here in a couple of minutes. After that, we're going to dive into the multi-channel aspect of email. We're going to look at the mobile aspect, and we're going to dive a bit more into social.